Hello, friends. I know that it's been some time since the last time I put out a video about a book. Thank you so much for the love that you have given me on my Alchemist videos. It's been 4 years, yes, but I had to take some time to go ahead and practice and apply in principle what I was learning, because as you know, I do read a whole lot. So as my comeback video, I've decided to do one about The Message of the Master. It's a book by John McDonald. It's really great, and I think that you guys will really enjoy my summary of it. First of all, this book has mysterious origins, so you know that's always a good thing, right? So the author is completely unknown. It was given to the publisher by his delivery driver while he was delivering things on a particular day. And he said, hey, you publish books, why don't you publish this one? And so the publisher tried to find out a little bit more about the book's origins, but it was all a dead end. He could find out nothing. So he decided to publish it and make it available to the world and to all of us because, you know, capitalism, right? Yeah. So it's very concise. It's only 83 pages long. It is split up into two parts. The first part of several chapters is called The Search. The next part is called The Message, and that's the rest of the book. The advice that is given at the beginning of the book is that we all should be applying the lessons in a way that actually fits you and your personality. And the second bit of advice is to go ahead and write down new ideas while you read. Let's begin with the actual story. So this book is narrated by an unknown person. We never ever get to find out the narrator's name, but we do get to understand that he's currently stressed out in his business. He's losing clients, he's losing revenue, he's really, really sad. You know when you go through a situation where it looks like everything is collapsing, everything is falling down around you? Yeah. I've been through that. You've been through that, right? I know. We all have. So this is the kind of place where we find the narrator when we start the book. Now, he has a friend that he last saw 1 month ago as the guy was getting on a ship because his doctor had ordered him to go ahead and take a European vacation. Now, this friend of his had also been going through a really bad situation. Everything was collapsing. It was total darkness. And so he was really sick, depressed. Sounds to me like maybe he had a nervous breakdown. So his doctor said maybe he should take a European vacation, and that's what he did. Now, many of his friends, as they stood at the quay seeing him off, really thought that that might be the last time they would ever see him. So you can imagine. So check this out. This friend has returned after only a month and seems to have made a miraculous recovery and transformation. Like, it is a wonder to everybody around who sees him. So the entire business community in this town is completely abuzz with the information, and everyone is remarking and commenting on what a transformation this friend has made. So the friend is actually on the phone calling our narrator, and the narrator notices that he is now vibrant and energetic. He believes he's the luckiest man alive. He also mentions that he has learned a great new secret. He now understands that nothing is impossible for him to be, do, or have. The first thing that our narrator asks his friend is, "Did you join a cult?" Because the transformation in him is just so amazing that he kind of feels like there might be something fishy about this. But his friend responds, "No, I have met a master." In the book, this is explained as a person whose personal powers have become fully developed, where they are able to literally make anything happen that they want to happen. So this kind of ties into the idea of the alchemist. Being an alchemist, that's you're able to turn base metals into gold. But metaphysically, what the idea of alchemy means is that you're able to transform situations that are not to your liking and make them much more to your liking. So that's a little tidbit for you, okay? So the narrator and friend arranged to meet ASAP. Well, our narrator is in a big hurry. He says, "Listen, I have to come and talk to you because I have to understand what has gone on, you know?" And here is a lesson that I learned here, which is, what do you do when times are dark? What do you actually do when things aren't going the way that you want them to go? Because reaching out and asking for help, going to see somebody, going to talk to someone, doing anything that is in front of you, anything that's presented to you where you think that possibly could be an answer out of the situation. Because let me tell you one thing, every problem has a solution. You just might not be seeing the solution from the place where you are currently, okay? That goes for everybody. I might not see it because currently my level of consciousness does not allow me to see the solution to the problem. You know that famous saying, a problem cannot be solved at the same level of consciousness that created it. So you have to ascend to the next level to find a solution. So here's the thing. What do you do when times are dark? What do you do when all seems hopeless? In my opinion, this was a great example of somebody reaching out. Everything seems terrible, but this person seems to have found something and I want to know about it. So reach out. He is unable to concentrate on work or even think about all the problems he's been bothered about for the last several weeks, months, who knows. And he just can't concentrate on any of that anymore because all he keeps thinking about is how alive his friend sounded for somebody that everybody actually thought might be dead very soon, right? So he's curious and very excited. He decides to leave the office and spends the whole afternoon taking a long walk around the city until it's evening and the time that they've arranged to meet. Now, when he gets to the place where they had arranged to meet, he realizes that his friend is a no-show. But the friend has left a message for him at the front desk saying that he would really love to reschedule and that he was not able to make it that day. Now, as he turns to leave, he notices some other friends as well who also know this friend who has come back, and everybody is still talking about what has happened and the transformation that has occurred with this friend of theirs. So the narrator leaves severely disappointed, and then the book says he walks out into the dark night. So again, here's another darkness symbolism, right? Letting you know just where this guy is. And one thing that I can say to you is, during a very dark period that I had 2 years ago, one thing that really helped me was continuing to tell myself every day that one day the light would break. One day it would be morning. One day the dawn will come. And so even though it continued day after day after day after day, and it looked like it was never, ever going to end, I just said to myself, nope, one day the dawn will come. And that helped me a lot to not make it a permanent situation in my mind, to understand that one day the dawn will always come. The night cannot last forever. So that might help you too if you need it. Feel free to use that. So now here's the friend's story. When they do get to meet, they schedule another meeting, and then they meet up in a private dining room at a very upscale restaurant. And so the friend arrives in a luxury automobile, and that's still letting us know again just how much his life, his business, his finances have transformed since he returned from Europe. Now the friend, in addition, seems calmed, poised. He's clearly healthy and, of course, clearly wealthy now. He seems to also possess a secret power that puts everyone around him at ease. So this is something that you're going to continue to see as we move through the book, this power of putting people at ease. He tells the narrator that he had been in a dark place and was probably suicidally depressed, but he just did not have the ability to go through with the suicide thoughts. So while in London, he decided to go to the theater. So here's another example of what I was talking about earlier. What are you doing while it's dark? Here is somebody who is literally like in the most hopeless situation, but he decides to go to the theater, you know, go and try to bring some music into his life, bring some entertainment into his life. You know, whatever it is that you're able to do in a situation like this, believe me, it will go a long way versus sitting in, yes, accept the dark, of course. Embrace the dark even. Don't resist it, because resistance only makes things stronger. However, whenever you're able to, if you can get up and go somewhere where you'll know you'll laugh, you'll know you have a little fun, you know that, you know, you'll be entertained, by all means do that. So while at the theater, well, first of all, he purchases a really cheap ticket because that's all he can afford, but then realizes that once he's escorted to his seat, he's put in the box seats. So that's shocking to him, but initially. But now, while he's talking to our narrator, he says, listen, coincidences are actually quite commonplace. We just call them coincidences because we don't really understand the power that we have. But to the person who truly understands their power, and to the one who has the right knowledge, these coincidences will actually become the norm in your life, right? Meeting the right person just when you need it, getting just the right piece of information, etc. So here's the first time he encounters the master. This is happening at the theater. He meets a really unique individual. I mean, this person exudes radiance and charisma. People are drawn to him. He has an attractive quality. And then also people treat him with the utmost deference and respect. The other thing is when you're talking to someone like this, you feel completely at ease in their presence. This has been said about quite a few great people. I know the former president, Bill Clinton, a lot of people have said this about him. I have spoken to a monk before where I felt exactly the same way. You know, when you're talking to someone who's heart is just so pure, and also they are not in their heads being focused on anything at all. They're completely focused on you. For the moment that you're right in front of them, they make you feel like you are the only person in the world and the most important person in the room. So this is what this is about. Now, on the level of charisma, if you have read the Kybalion or any kind of work like that, then you understand that this is the male aspect. You know, we all have a male and a female aspect. The male aspect has to do with charisma. And that's both whether you're a man or a woman, whatever your gender, that doesn't matter. Your physical gender, that does not matter. I'm talking metaphysically. We all have both. And so the male aspect, when you nurture your male aspect, you nurture the charismatic side of you. This is what makes you attractive. This is what makes people want to come around you. You know, this is what makes you just exude that thing that people just can't stay away from. Okay, anyway. So the friend shares his troubles with the master while they're hanging out at the theater, and then they go out to dinner later. When they're done with dinner, the master does this strange thing where he pays the bill simply by initialing on it. And so the friend says to him, hey, like, do you come here often? You know, like, do they know where to find you? And the master says, oh, don't worry, it will be paid. And no, this is my very first time ever at this restaurant. I've never been here, but I just did that to show you that nothing is impossible when you have the right knowledge. And then the master tells him that he will be taking a cruise ship to New York. The friend immediately asks to accompany him because he wants to continue being around this man and learning from him. The master agrees, but when the friend rushes over to buy his ticket to New York, he finds out that the New York cruise is sold out and there are no tickets left. So just as he's turning away disappointed and about to leave, he gets called back and told that a cancellation has just occurred, and it happened just in time. So he's able to get tickets and he's able to get on board. Later, the master tells him that he had made a place for him. And so that's where I'm going to stop. This will cover the first three chapters.